Okay, our hangout is now live and on the air. Julia was with me, but she had to take care of something and she will be here shortly. So it is our plan to talk about songs that are banned. Mimzy Vids and Dina Tokio, those are actually topics that Julia is an expert on. I don't know that much about it. And I wanted to talk a little about why I am suspicious of the MasterClass series. And in the process of talking about that, I thought that we could also discuss the somewhat uncomfortable situation of being between generations of authors and, you know, being a living author who is not yet well known, but who is a contemporary of other authors, some of whom have died and some of whom have not yet died, but are considered to be veterans. And where does all this fit in for us? So I see that we have a viewer, but I'm going to now try to share the live stream with other people. Okay, so I have that on my other computer and I'm copying it and I'm going to share it on Facebook. And on I'm going to also share this on Twitter. All right. So people have been talking about the song Baby It's Cold Outside. Apparently it was banned and some people thought it was a song about sexual assault or rape. And then there are other people who said, no, it's not about that. It's about slut shaming. And the person I see that Julia has tagged me. Okay, so they're saying, no, it's really about slut shaming. And so this woman actually wanted to stay with the man, but she was afraid that the neighbors would gossip and her mother would say this and so would say that and so on and so forth. But really, during the time when it was commonplace for a woman to demur on the grounds that it was not socially acceptable for her to stay with a man overnight, because it would end up in her reputation being ruined. okay, that's possible that it was partly society being judgmental of women who were unattached, but it was also a way in which women collectively got men to marry them and to make a promise to support their children. And so a lot of these supposedly slut-shamed women were actually using this excuse that they would be shamed in order to get themselves into a safe and secure and monogamous partnership situation so they could support their children. So, I don't really have anything to say about that. As individuals, we can choose what we do. I don't think that necessarily talking about society forcing people into situations is just not really that clear cut. One person was slut shamed, one person was given a scarlet letter, but let's remember who was doing this scarlet lettering kind of thing. And a lot of times it was women, and it was because they wanted to maintain their order. Okay, and Julia says she's back. So, yeah, okay, let me just send a link to Julia. Oh, there she is.
Okay, I'm so sorry about all that. People have bad timing. And it's not that they don't mind being on camera, because my mom would want to be on camera. She wanted me to go outside and talk to my dad.
Okay. Well, I'd love to meet your family, so there's no problem with that if they would like to.
Well, they're not. They left. It wasn't even that. I just told her, we do the show at 6:45, and I'm here at 6:45, so I was sitting here and I was talking with you, and she kept just making, like, she didn't care she was on camera, but it was that she wanted me to, it was just, it's so
we are alive now, okay?
Yeah. I'm so sorry. I don't really know, by the way, because I'm kind of upset, because I just want to keep, I like doing the show, and I want to do it on time. That's all.
Yeah, no, that's okay. That's all right. I was afraid that maybe for a moment you thought that we weren't live, but we are.
Yeah, no, I don't even care. Like, if they know that later on, I told them, I'm like, yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I mean, you know what? I would love to invite my family members to be on the show too, but most people are so shy.
Oh, I don't think that they're even shy. It's just that she wants me to do what she thinks I should do whenever she decides to do this. So get this, their car broke down today. So they were at the car dealership and they were getting it fixed. And I told her every Friday night at 6:45, I do a show with Aya. It's something that I enjoy doing. It is a time commitment. This is something I do. I have explained this to them. So anyway, she didn't mind being on the show. It's just that she thought, oh, it's not that big of a deal. You can stop whatever you're doing and go outside and talk to your dad, because we showed up right now. That was kind of the thing that I just thought, I don't get it. But no worries. That was just what was frustrating about the whole thing. That's all.
Yeah, no, that's okay. Yeah, I mean, your dad could be on the show too. I mean, you know, I watch Merlene McCohen, and Merlene McCohen has her mom, her dad, her sister, her brother, and all their birds on her show. So we could do that.
I would love to. I think my mom would be okay with it. She, if she could stay, but it's just like, I don't think he would want to be on. She might be, if I was doing it up in the mountains, she would probably be on in the background. She's retired now. I don't think she cares. Like, I really don't think she cares at all. And my other sister, like, would probably, she does live streams of her own. I don't think she would care, but I don't think, it's just a timing thing. I'm like, okay. But anyway, I don't want to go on and on about that. I just wanted to, I was late.
That's all right. Yeah. So I was attempting very badly to talk about Baby It's Cold Outside. So I think I'll let you talk about it for a while.
Okay. So let me talk about it. Like, I don't even care like that deeply about the song, but the reason I started becoming bothered by it was because I heard, oh, they're banning the song, and then they're trying to say, oh, it's slut shaming and it's all this and that. But then I kind of knew, like, in my intuition, because just from, like, thinking about things, sometimes things are blown out of proportion. And it turned out it definitely was. First off, I don't think songs should be banned. Like, why? It's somebody's form of creative expression. And then it turns out I wanted to, like, kind of do a screen share just of what the daughter said about the article, because I thought it was interesting. The daughter of the composer, she said it wasn't even what people thought it was. It was because of a skit. I was trying to get back to, I don't remember deleting it off my wall, but I just was like, there has to be something more to it. Because every time I read an article about something and people say, oh, it's this, it's some grandiose thing, this has more meaning to it than it really does, it turns out that's actually not the case. Oh, yeah. So I do want to do like a screen share. I just wanted to, is that okay if I just kind of share the article on screen share?
Great.
Okay, so I'm going to go to screen share. It's going to put us into all these different things. Okay, so I just wanted to go, let's see. Okay, so it's not a date rape song, Baby It's Cold Outside.
Baby It's Cold Outside is a popular holiday tune.
So, like, it's not a date rape song is basically what she's saying. So the daughter, you know, Bill Cosby says that Bill Cosby, I don't even know if I... That's just her take on it. I'm like, I wasn't even like a big Cosby fan, to be honest with you, back in the day. But I think people are making a lot of that too. Like, I don't know. You know, we talked about that before. But she was basically saying that, you know, I'm annoyed that a father. Okay, so basically it was a song my father wrote for him and my mother to sing at parties. So it seemed like it was a nice thing that their families did, like a duet. And it was just, it's been taken out of proportion because
Bing Crosby that you're talking about, the daughter of Bing Crosby?
Oh, no. What she was saying was that she felt like Bill Crosby. It's the daughter of Frank Loeser who composed the song. But what she was saying was she feels like Bill Cosby, like, ruined it for everybody because there was a skit on Saturday Night Live where they made a parody of the song with Bill Cosby. It goes into it like later on. Okay. Saturday Night Live previously linked the song to Cosby in December 2015 episode that aired just days before the comedian accused by. Yeah, so basically she was saying that she didn't like what bothered the daughter was that there was a skit on Saturday Night Live and people started writing all these articles about it, linking the song to Bill Cosby, but there was actually no connection. It was just a Saturday Night Live skit. And it was like this runaway train. And she just was kind of disappointed about it because it was a song originally that her father wrote for her mother so they could perform it at parties. Oh. And it wasn't this horrible thing that everybody made it out to be. That was my only point about that. But I just kind of followed my intuition on that because I felt like every time people say something is really bad or has a bad meaning, I like to figure out, well, is that true or not? So I continued doing my research and I figured out, well, no, it wasn't true. Like, they blew it out of proportion. But I know there's other articles about it too where they were saying that it was akin to slut shaming, but is that really the case? Like, did you cover that yet, Aya? Were you already?
I tried to, but I was very inarticulate about it. So here's what I think. Many times back in the day, when there was a social taboo about premarital sex, there were girls who used that social taboo to get guys to marry them, you know? So it's not like that social taboo was really against women. It was, you know, some women did whatever they felt like doing. If they were in love, they stayed overnight and it was no big deal. And nobody even had to know about it, right?
No, they didn't. And I think also too, just social mores changed a little bit with the Victorian era, like perceived social mores, because even in like colonial America among the Puritans, they said premarital sex wasn't unknown. And actually a lot of women ended up getting married because they were going to have a baby. Like things, just perceptions changed a little bit.
Right.
You know, just from what I read in the history, it's like, there's always been people and they've always done things that were probably not socially or morally acceptable, but things happen. Like, it's not like things have changed all of a sudden. And I think we just perceive it that way because we have this cultural change. That's my take on it.
Right. But I mean, even those women who said no sex before marriage, what were they really, and they were saying because that's the social rule, but what they were getting out of that was a certain amount of security for themselves and their future children. So it's not really that society had these women under its thumb. It's usually that women were using that social rule to get something, you know? So
yeah, you would get more security. You'd have more family security. I can say this actually with the change, just one thing I have noticed, and a lot of men, they don't think that they have to get married anymore. Like, what's the point? Like, they don't want to get married. In fact, that was actually one thing I encountered just with dating in general that I personally didn't like, because I thought, well, if I am dating, I would like to date to have a relationship, like a stable relationship. But a lot of men, they don't feel that they have to do that anymore because they're like, well, there's no social rule that says we should get married. And I encountered that a lot. And it's not that I'm extremely old fashioned. I just want stability. And it was like, for me, it was difficult to always find someone who would agree with that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, in a lot of senses, young women today don't have a lot of bargaining power at all. They're expected to give everything at once and to carry the entire load themselves. And
why would you want to? And another thing too, that I almost think is worse now, like they think, I don't know, and this is just my other way of looking at it. They say that women are so empowered now, but I feel like it's the same idea, but it's just slightly tweaked. Like now women are like, oh, because I'm acting like Kim Kardashian and I'm doing all these things, like I'm empowered. But in a way, I feel like it's sort of worse because they're still doing that for attention. And is that better? Like, I don't always think that's a better way of going about things. Like, how is that way of putting yourself out there just because you can? Like, I'm not saying you have to be like perfectly moral, but I just think it's sad we live in this world where like a music icon is somebody who, and I'm not prudish or anything, but is somebody that's very scantily clad and has to dance around like that, but she's empowered because she's the one doing it. Like, that's one thing that I question, honestly, about music today. Like, I don't find very interesting about what's popular.
Well, I mean, certainly the song lyrics are very crude. And I think that the music that goes with it isn't much, you know, much more refined than that. But, you know, you can say I'm just old fashioned. So.
And that's actually okay. Like, I actually like creative music, and there are good bands out there. There are people who write really good songs and produce great music, but I feel like you're not going to see that like in a mainstream song because it's the same message. It's just, it seems like now, like, oh, because a woman's doing it and she's putting herself out there like that, it's more entertaining or it's more empowered. I don't think so, but that's not here nor there. I think music was actually better in that time period than it is now. And the lyrics are disgusting. Like, you'll hear people driving down the street, like, listening to that, but that's okay. But the song, Baby, It's Cold Outside, needs to be banned. Like, I think you need to check your lyrics, maybe.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's even, it's not even just about the crudeness of the language. I think there's something about the form of the song that has changed too. And I also, you know, it's a totally different thing if two people are feeling the same thing at the same time. And so, you know, they decide to do what they feel like doing, and both sides are into it at the same time. But right now, I think that a lot of young women are being coerced into situations where they don't think they're going to be cool unless they do something. And but we can't talk about that, can we?
I think we kind of can, and I actually kind of want to. That's actually kind of, you just kind of put more succinctly what I was thinking. I kind of don't like the way music or just like trendiness or popularity is going. And I don't even think it started with exactly Kim Kardashian. I think this kind of started with Paris Hilton a few years back before all the Instagram things. I don't know if you're familiar with her. Are you familiar like with Paris Hilton?
I don't know. I have an image in my head of a blonde with a little purse and a tiny dog in it, but I don't know if that's her or not.
And she never really did anything, okay? So she had this show, and it was called The Simple Life, and they just went and lived in the country, and they were just, they weren't really doing anything, and it just seemed like this whole persona of women, but yet somehow that's empowered. I don't think that's necessarily being empowered, like, and it kind of goes a little bit into the whole Me Too thing. Like, it's not that I care if people want to do Me Too, but I think it goes back to what we were saying, or I was saying about Blossom. Like, her mom said, don't put up with directors or people that have, like, sleazy expectations. Like, don't work with those people, period, in the sentence. But she got a lot of hate for saying that just because she said she wouldn't put herself in situations that would compromise herself. Mm-hmm. You know?
You're talking about Mayim Bialik, right?
Yes, Mayim Bialik. I keep calling her Blossom. I know Mayim Bialik.
Okay. Yeah. I know.
Yeah. So that was her whole stance on Me Too. But then she had to clarify herself. It's like, supposedly we have free speech, but all she was saying was her mom told her, if some guy tries to hug you, you don't have to accept a hug from him if it makes you feel uncomfortable. Or you don't have to do this certain role or wear a certain outfit if that makes you feel compromised. And this, but people thought that she was criticizing other women because she had that standard for herself. But I don't think it's a big deal. Like, I think you can always say no. I don't.
Yes, you should be able to say no. Now, if somebody rapes you, that's totally different, and you should report that. But if somebody is told, well, unless you sleep with me, you don't get the role, you have the right to say, well, then I don't want the role.
Yeah, I guess that's all I'm trying to say. Like, I'm not trying to criticize the whole Me Too movement. I guess, like, it's very important to people. But another thing, like, I've just heard some women say, well, it's kind of odd because they're in this position, they got the opportunities, but now after the fact, they're complaining, you know, like, why did they wait so long? Yeah. I guess that's another question I have, like, why did you wait so many years?
Yeah, and that, of course, especially if you are accusing somebody of rape, and that's a very serious accusation, you want to have all the evidence to back you up, because you have the burden of proof, and there's a reason for that. We have due process.
And why is that so important? Because I know you have a lot of legal background, and you could kind of explain.
Well,
like,
because otherwise, we could, you know, the moment you don't like somebody, you get 1,000 women to say that he raped them, and you have no proof. And if the burden is not on those women to prove it, then anytime you want to get somebody in trouble, you can do that. So that's why in the Constitution, you know, there's due process, and even in the common law, There is a burden of proof, and it's on the person who claims something bad was done.
Yeah, exactly. And that, to me, that makes common sense. Like, oh yeah, I was thinking about another thing. Like, I haven't been in the teaching profession for years, but I do remember a story that they told us that you should never be alone in a room with a student, because there was this principal, this administrator, a few years back. Like, I guess he just touched this girl's knee. Like, she was in the office, she had done something wrong, these middle school girls, just like to emphasize a point. But these two girls, they made up a story about him. They said that he was lascivious and he was touching their knees, and he was fired and he was sued, and he died of a heart attack soon after that. Like, he lost his whole livelihood because of a lie that these two girls told. And everybody knew, like all the people that worked with him knew that that was a lie, but he couldn't defend himself because of the story that they concocted. So,
right.
We do have to keep in mind,
which leads us into the story of Vice President Pence, who has a policy that he will never meet for lunch alone with a woman, you know, not alone, but in a restaurant even, unless he is accompanied by his wife. And the whole reason is because right now it's so easy to accuse somebody of something. So he wants to stay safe. But we really don't want to live in a society where a man cannot meet alone for a business lunch with a woman in a restaurant, because then we can go back to the kind of society where every woman has to cover her head and can't go out without her husband.
Yeah, exactly. Good point. Like, in Saudi Arabia, they have a Starbucks that has a family area where you can meet. And there was this businesswoman and this businessman. They conducted business in the family area, but the authorities assumed, oh, they must be meeting for a rendezvous, even though it was a business. And they both went to prison for some time. She was soon released, but it took many months before he was released from prison. And we used to think, oh, well, that's just preposterous. Like, how could they think that? But we could be going that way in some regards if we're always, like,
right,
the burden of doubt, proof to be on a man, like, prove. And another thing, too, like, Aya, that I just have concerns with is, like, a lot of women complain, well, men, they don't really ask women out anymore, or they don't really compliment them, because this is what I've heard, like, to be, I don't feel this way. I like it when someone compliments me, like, if I'm wearing a nice dress, but some women will say it's sexual harassment if a man compliments them on their dress. Like, to me, that's just so ridiculous. Like, nobody can compliment each other anymore on anything, because it might be taken out of context, you know?
Right. Yeah. So we're on our way to a pre-Victorian, you know, kind of society where nothing is possible, and nothing is possible because we're going to assume the worst. And why are we going to assume the worst? Because we forgot about the burden of proof and due process.
That's a very good point. So I guess I could kind of just touch on, since we're talking, we mentioned Saudi Arabia, I was mentioning Mimzy Vids. I think, have you heard about her?
Only from you, so I'll let you tell me about her.
So Mimzy Vids, she's a smaller YouTuber, but I guess she's been on my radar lately because I was watching Dina Tokio, and she did a video about Dina Tokio. Dina Tokio, I find interesting. She's half English and half Egyptian. I don't know why. I'm just very, like, interested in people that are half, because my dad's, like, half Syrian and half English, I guess you could say, in ancestry. So she just intrigues me. So she's living in England, and she's always worn a headscarf, Dina Tokio. But recently she decided that she didn't want to wear a headscarf anymore. And I guess she is still a Muslim, but she doesn't want to wear it. But now all these people are coming out, and they're leaving, like, hate comments on her channel and calling her names and harassing her on the internet just because she decided she didn't want to wear a headscarf. So Mimzy is actually, she's not even a Muslim anymore. Like, she's an atheist, I believe. Like, she's left Islam, and she has been doing videos like, why are you criticizing Dina Tokio for not wearing a headscarf when by the way, like, there's all these Muslim men that criticize her, and some of them are into boxing. And it turns out in Islam, you're not supposed to box, but it's just interesting that they're criticizing this woman for not wearing a headscarf. And then even Mimzy, like, I guess she's saying, you know, it's interesting that in 26 Islamic countries, you can't even leave Islam. And these are ones that we would think are a little bit more moderate. Like, you can't even leave Islam, or you're considered a heretic, or your family might try to kill you. And I was reading in the comments on one of her videos that this one man, he lives in Malaysia, and he was thanking her for her videos because he decided he doesn't want to be a Muslim anymore. But a lot of kids are scared in Malaysian schools because they'll tell the kids in class, if you don't wear a headscarf, that you're going to go to hell and your skin will burn off and it will keep burning and growing back. This is pretty scary stuff, but we're not ever supposed to criticize Islam at all. And these are people that were Muslims and they decided that the religion didn't make sense to them and they're leaving. And they said, you know, what's interesting when you leave Islam, like, you can leave any other religion or criticize any other religion, but if you leave Islam, like, the reaction is much more severe than any other. Like, if you leave Judaism or Christianity, I don't think people are going to be attacking that person in the comments on a video the way that they would attack a former Muslim. It's just kind of disconcerting, I think, for freedom of speech.
Yeah, well, yes, there's an asymmetry there in the way that we're treating that particular religion right now in our society, and we have to be kind of careful. And Nassim Taleb talks about that a little bit in his book, that, you know, we can say all religions are the same and we have to show respect to all of them, but we have to be careful about those that make it very hard not to follow, you know, those that don't believe that it would be okay for somebody to leave the faith.
And it's not always okay.
Yeah.
And I don't want to make this all about religion. I'm just, like, sharing her experiences because I think she's kind of interesting. Like, I think she seems like a very low-key vlogger. Like, she just drinks tea and she's having these conversations, but she's getting these hate comments. Like, there's, like, these Islamic, like, people that are pro, I guess they give speeches about it on YouTube. They're coming to her channel personally. She's just a woman. She just decided she didn't want to be part of this religion anymore. And they're, like, targeting her just because of her opinion, which seems really odd. Like, why would somebody that purports to be a religious scholar just be going to somebody's YouTube videos that says that they no longer want to be of a certain faith anymore? It's just like, well, if we were to make the analogy, like, let's say somebody left Judaism, I don't see a lot of rabbis, like, going to somebody doing that. Like, I just don't see that. Or even, like, a Christian minister, like, do you but not to that degree. Like,
okay, let's historically, there have been those kinds of things. Historically, what usually happened is if somebody left the faith in the diaspora, I'm talking about the Jews in the diaspora, then that person would be, like, dead to the family. So they wouldn't go and harass them, but there would be consequences. And of course, under Christianity, under the Inquisition, there was terrible religious persecution of people who didn't want to be Christians anymore. Oh,
yeah, you're right. I'm not saying that there weren't.
It's just not happening right now. It is not. That's not what rabbis are known for right now.
Yeah.
Certainly not in the United States. And it's not what Christians are known for right now. So, you know, I think it's good to have the historical perspective and realize Islam is not the only religion that has behaved that way.
Oh, for sure.
There are followers, certain followers of Islam, who are being very obnoxious, and this should not be allowed. You know, we shouldn't just sit there and allow it.
Oh, no, and I do think, like, in certain eras of Islam, like, even during the Ottoman Empire, like, I think they were much more accepting because they did allow, like, Jewish people and Christian people. And I'm not saying that there hasn't been tolerance in Islam, because definitely there is a degree of tolerance in certain eras and certain versions of it. It's just the commentary, I guess. And I guess maybe it's not a big deal at the end of the day if somebody leaves a whole bunch of bad comments on somebody's channel, like, I guess there could be worse things. It could be
I mean, I have people who leave comments about Bo, you know, so about chimpanzees, about how they hate chimpanzees or psychopaths or whatever, you know, and I just delete those comments because what can I do, right?
Yeah, true. So maybe that's another thing too, like maybe you should just delete those kind of comments. And I guess another question is, do people keep those comments? Because then it kind of gets more views. That could be another question, I guess.
I guess so, yeah. No, when I get a comment that I don't like, I've come to the opinion that there's no point in arguing about that. You know, if they're haters, they're gonna hate, right?
Yeah, they're always gonna not like something. Yeah, no, definitely, like in a historical context, I would say other Abrahamic religions have done deplorable things to people, and the Spanish Inquisition is one example, many others. Like, I'm not condoning that. I'm just saying currently, like, it's interesting that
it's actually the liberals who are saying, okay, Islam is somehow we should bend over backwards because somehow they're a protected class and the other religions are not a protected class.
And that's another thing too that I think is interesting, because why? Like, there are actually people that are, like, supposedly liberals, like, they think, well, atheists should be able to speak their mind. And a lot of this issue, I'm not even an atheist. I don't really, because I'll be honest with you, I'm not. But I think that anybody has the right to believe what they want to believe. So why is it that an atheist is being chagrined just because they're criticizing Islam? But if an atheist criticizes Christianity, that's okay, no big deal. But then if an atheist criticizes Islam, all of a sudden it's hate speech. But if it's a person that was a Muslim, I think they might just be sharing their experience about why they're leaving this faith. Like, if it was somebody who left Mormonism, nobody would be complaining right now. But because Mimzy Vids and her husband left Islam, they're being, like, targeted as hate speech. And that's not what they are at all. Like, they're just sharing their experiences.
Well, I mean, the whole concept of hate speech is, there's a problem with it, you know? I mean, because it doesn't treat all people the same. If we treat all people and all religions the same, and say, okay, as long as you're not hurting anybody else, go ahead and practice your religion. The moment you start to hurt somebody else, sorry, the other person's rights are more important than your religion.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's it.
Yeah, exactly. They were just talking about some other issues that are kind of current too, and I don't want to go way, way deep into religion, but it has to do with, like, the headscarf. They say that it's always a woman's choice, and that's what we always thought, but this kind of goes into the whole Dina Tokio thing again. I guess she's, I don't know in her case for sure, maybe it was her choice, but she was saying in some circles it's not always a choice, but women are told to say that to the general public, but later on they decide that no, it really wasn't their choice. Their family made them feel like that they had to wear the headscarf. So, and this is happening, like, in the UK, which this is a westernized country. So I just think it's an interesting topic of the moment is all, you know.
Right. So the question is, well, it might be a woman's choice, but then she might have to leave her family in order to exercise that choice.
Yeah, and that's what they're saying. And that actually, that is happening where a lot of people, they do have to leave their family. And another issue in some of the, and I don't want to target, like, a specific religion, but I did watch a few documentaries about this, and it happens in Australia where there are women, like, they're of the Islamic faith, but it turns out that their parents are trying to encourage them to marry a first cousin. And David Cameron had actually talked about this a little bit in the UK, that first cousin marriage is an issue in like a lot of the immigrant, specifically Islamic communities, because women are kind of being pressured. And Mimzy's just talking about things like this, which I think are kind of fascinating because she's an insider and she kind of knows about these things. She's heard the stories, and it's just interesting to hear her share her opinion. And that was pretty much it, you know?
Okay. Yeah, sure. And as far as first cousin marriages, I mean, wasn't that a practice that until very recently was done in many countries?
I think so. I think a lot of people are distant cousins, and I don't even think cousin marriage is a bad thing if cousins want to get married. It was just that they feel like they have to. But I guess if two cousins want to get married, then that's their choice. I don't really care personally. But
didn't Einstein marry a cousin? I don't know. I mean, it's just... the Roosevelts were very...
They were cousins.
Yeah.
On my Syrian side, some of them, I think, are like distant cousins. Like, uh-huh. I would see several names that... And they all... Yeah, so it wasn't a big deal. It happened. Like, it happened in America, too. There were cousins that got married, like the Roosevelts. It's not a large deal. And yes, up until 200 years ago, cousin marriage was widely practiced throughout the world. Yes.
Right. So I don't want to be extremely upset about that. But the question is, do they want to or not? Are they? And that's the real issue, right? Consent.
Well, that was kind of what the documentary was talking about, just that sometimes these cousins didn't want to get married, and it wasn't always like the women. Sometimes it was the men. Like, there was this one person in the documentary, it turned out it was the man, and he was being forced, and the woman didn't even know this. Like, she thought he wanted to get married, and it turned out later on that his family forced him into this marriage. So it can go both ways as well.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, that was really all I was going to say about that. Was there another issue that you wanted to discuss?
Yeah. Well, what recently came up, many people may have seen these ads for the MasterClass series, where a celebrity comes on and he says that if you pay him a certain amount of money, then you can participate in his MasterClass. Mm-hmm. Have you seen that?
I've seen it, and I think you kind of know my feeling about the whole MasterClass thing. I don't like it. Sorry. I don't mean to, like, no, I'm going to be totally honest. It's a scheme to make money, in my opinion. Like, why do we need to pay for content when there's already plenty of good free content on YouTube by experts that do the same things? And just, and well, for example, like, I used to see these ads for Gordon Ramsay MasterClass cooking classes, but I'm going to be honest with you. I watched his show and I didn't really care for it. Like, he would just go to these businesses and scream at people. And then I read an article about a local business where it turned out that some of the people that worked on his show said not everything on the menu was as bad as he made it out to be. And they actually liked some of the items, but it was just Gordon Ramsay having to go on the show and scream at people and make like a big to-do, because that's the whole format. It's like shock TV. It's like reality TV, which I don't always care for as much, but some people really like that. So I guess they'll see Gordon Ramsay and he's like, I'm going to teach a master class on how to cook, and people might want to buy that. But I don't know why, because, by the way, he has his own videos for free on YouTube where he shows himself cooking, and he's not even my favorite chef of all time. Like, when I just watch him cook something, it didn't seem that interesting. Like, I've seen other people do it better, in my opinion, or maybe they prepare food that I find more palatable, I guess. So I don't really understand the point of purchasing it. It kind of reminds me of the whole buy the tapes on the telephone number where you call the 800 number and get a set of tapes. It just seems like they're pushing a product on us. I don't see what value you're going to get from paying that extra money for it. But that's just my take on the MasterClass.
Yeah, no, one that I saw, and I guess they're targeting us for our interests. So one that I saw was for Paul Krugman. Mm-hmm. And he's talking about money and the economy. And why would someone want to pay for this masterclass? I mean, he was an economics professor. He was, you know, chairman of the Fed. He publishes articles. He gives talks. And if he wanted to reach other people, the ones who don't go to university, who don't go to those talks, then he could actually offer this on YouTube or on some other internet resource. And it feels as if, I don't know, he's trying to sell something. And
yeah, exactly. Like, he's trying to sell a product. Well, let's think about it this way. I'm sure there's other people who know about economics, maybe his version of economics to the same extent, but this is my question about the masterclass. Would they be promoting that if it was just some obscure political wonk who was on it? Would they be making those videos and promoting it to the public the way that they are now, if it was just a random person nobody knew?
Well, probably not. So it's about celebrity, right?
Yeah, they want a celebrity. And I feel like it's a product. Like, they want to push this product, which is the masterclass. There's always some, like, there were other ones, like, back when you could dial that 800 number, it'd be like different classes that could teach you how to do this, or you could learn about this. And it would cater to a certain demographic. For instance, some of those tapes, they would cater to commuters because they could pop this tape into their car and listen to this topic and they could accumulate this knowledge. But it's interesting because I don't see what you would get from that program that you couldn't get from other content in a book or that's online already, that's free, that's a little bit less money. That's just my take on the whole masterclass. They're using a celebrity to push a product.
Right. That's how it looks to me. But, you know, because I'm an author and I'm not a well-known author, I also have to ask myself, am I biased or am I somehow envious of the celebrity of the better-known authors? Because I am in this time where I would like to talk about my experiences as a writer. I would love to sponsor other people by sharing what I've gone through. But because I'm not a celebrity by any means, you know, that opportunity is perhaps misinterpreted. And so, you know, that's why I'm not sure, but it just feels really odd to see a celebrity author offering a masterclass when they could be teaching that at university or just offering it for free on YouTube.
Yeah, for sure. I think, like, okay, basically this is my take and this may offend some people, but let's just be honest. Like, this masterclass, as those 800 number tapes in the past, they're being offered to the general public. These are people that are not going to go to a university or pursue a higher degree in a subject. They're not going, like, for instance, if you really wanted to learn how to cook, you'd go to culinary school, or maybe you would take a few classes, like, if you were truly that invested. These classes are just being offered to people who have a general interest in a topic. They're not, and I think they're a little bit more interested in celebrity. I think it's just another version of the 800 number, buy the tapes. It's a product. So it kind of reminds me of the whole rich dad, poor dad thing. Like, by the way that he made money was by selling his books and his product. Like, it wasn't that he had tips. Like, basically all the tips you could find in that book, you could accumulate from reading other investment books.
Right.
Following that program, like, you can find the same information for free on the internet, or you could buy a book,
right,
learn the same information.
Right, exactly. So if it is, for instance, a famous author. You could obviously read all their books. That's a good idea. Secondly, if they've written an autobiography, you could read that. Thirdly, they usually appear on television many, many times. They do interview shows. Mm-hmm. You could see that. And, you know, if they are interested in speaking directly to the public, they can appear on YouTube or on their own website in videos. And I'm not saying they shouldn't want to make more money, because no matter how much money you have, you could always make more and support that. I believe in free enterprise. So if they want to give it for a fee, or if they want to have ads running, all of that is okay. But there's something fishy about the organization of the masterclasses themselves.
It's another PR thing, I think. Like, when I think about it, I think, you know, there's PR firms. They're going to package something a certain way to make it seem interesting. And I really think, like, this product's just being, the way it's being geared, and it's not to criticize anybody, I think it's really being packaged towards a general audience that's maybe somewhat curious about a person, but they're not going to delve extremely deep into a certain topic. And they might buy this masterclass for those reasons, and that's about it. It's just kind of a, not to say that they have a superficial interest in the topic, but they don't have a deep enough interest to pursue a degree in it or a personal learning, like just to make it their personal hobby to learn all about this topic.
Right. But hey, like I said, I'm all for free enterprise. And even if it's something like a multi-level marketing scheme, mm-hmm. You know, as long as nobody gets hurt, it's fine. And
That's fine. Yeah. I don't really care what, if people want to do that and they want to buy that, I'm not against it. I guess what I'm just saying it's akin to that. Like, I don't think it's anything like.
Yeah. Okay. So let me put it this way. Let's say I were a celebrity. Let's say I were, you know, somewhere down the line, I become famous and everybody reads my books. And everybody wants to talk to me and everybody wants to know what my secret is. I would just go ahead and continue to talk to people on YouTube and tell them, you know, what I believe in, what my story is about writing these books, what the backstory is. I don't think I would be part of that program.
I don't think I would be either. Like, it's just kind of a gimmicky thing. Like, you know, a gimmick. I think that's all it is. And there's nothing wrong with the, that's just what I see about the masterclass. I don't find it that fascinating, honestly. I just thought those ads were kind of annoying.
I was annoyed by them in the same way that I was annoyed when Jane Goodall appeared in an ad on a Bow video. Now, mind you, I know Jane Goodall is a celebrity. And she does know a lot about chimpanzees, and she did some pioneering work. But now she's gathering money for her institute, and she's taking it from the federal government. She's taking it everywhere she can. And so when she appeared in an ad on a Bow video, and she was hoop panting, she was going, ooh, ooh. I just thought that was not classy. I'm sorry. It's not.
No, she's a, okay, there's nothing wrong with making money. That's all fine and good. But let's be honest, some people are really into celebrity and what they can accumulate from a celebrity career. Like, that was actually the rift that Jimmy Carter had with the Clintons, because he criticized the Clintons. He said, well, why don't they just do charity because they want to? It seems like they turn everything into a glitzy celebrity thing. And by the way, there was this article that I think is kind of interesting. Like, everybody thinks Hillary Clinton's all about, like, the working class people, and she cares about, like, unions and people that, like, are struggling. But guess whose wedding she went to? Do you know? Have you heard recently? And I'm not talking about Donald Trump.
Oh, no. Okay. Yeah. I'm like, this, like, about that one.
Well, I know I'm going to just share this article. I just thought it'd be interesting.
Okay.
Where is it? Like, so she went to the super rich Indian weddings. Like, she's attending these super rich
Indian wedding. Okay.
Yeah. But okay. So these people are celebrities and she's at their wedding, and because she's another celebrity, I guess. Like, it's just kind of a random article. It's not even that important. Like, I guess what I'm trying to say is it goes back to that idea just into, like, the celebrity of it all, like Jane Goodall a little bit to me. Like, I have no interest in Jane Goodall, but the impression I get from her now is that she kind of likes to promote herself to make money a little bit, which is good. I'm not saying that's bad, but that's just the impression.
Yeah, she has her institute, and you can say that it's not really for herself, but it's for chimpanzees in Africa. But to steal from chimpanzees in the United States to give to chimpanzees in Africa, in my opinion, is not a good idea.
No, it's not. It doesn't seem right. But I also think that they kind of, like, it's not... And I'm not saying anybody has to be humble, but they're not exactly doing, like, this humanitarian work or this volunteer work or charities because they really are worried. I think some of it does become of a celebrity thing. Like, they enjoy, like, these speaking opportunities and going to these weddings of other celebrities because
right. They
love being in that circle. That's kind of the impression I get from that.
Yeah, I mean, it's they do what they would do anyway, and they add charity to it. And it's highly visible.
Yeah. But why don't they just do, like, donate to something or do a charity because they want to, instead of making it into this I'm a do-gooder thing, I guess. I guess that's kind of my issue with it. My only issue with that kind of thing. Like, I don't think you're as... But anyway, I think I'm just getting kind of carried away with that. I guess all I was trying to say was the MasterClass thing. I don't think much of it except for it being kind of annoying in a way to maybe promote yourself. But in the long run, is that going to look good? Like, that's another question I have. Even if you are, like, a prestigious and this and that, like, in the long run, is anybody really going to care that you did that MasterClass segment? Or would they maybe, like, 100 years from now be more interested in, oh, you still have these videos on YouTube that anybody could watch, you know? Like, which one is more lasting? I guess that's my question.
Well, that depends on what goes on in the MasterClass. Now, the people who are actually paying for the MasterClass are assuming that there's a secret. The secret will be revealed to them in the MasterClass that is not revealed elsewhere. I don't think it's true.
No, that's kind of like that whole idea of the laws of attraction kind of thing. Like, there's a secret, like they turn the book into the secret. Like, there's some secret you're going to find out. So I looked at that book, like the laws of attraction, and all it kind of said was, oh, you have to make room for things in your life that you want. But I kind of have heard the same thing from other sources elsewhere. I don't think I have to read that specific book to hear that information.
Right.
I don't think there's any secret to be obtained, but maybe that's, once again, I think it's just a gimmick to get people to buy it because they're like, oh, I'm going to find this out. It's like a secret. But if you notice, every single one of them is like, I'm telling all my secrets. But if it was really a secret, you wouldn't be telling everybody. And they already do the same things for free on their YouTube channel, Gordon Ramsay. Like, he's done those cooking segments on his channel for free if you look for them. But if you want to pay for them in the MasterClass, I guess you can do that.
Right. And the thing is, if you actually get some kind of, I don't know, one-on-one tutelage, then I can maybe understand. But I doubt that that's what's going on there.
No, I don't think so. I just think it's another thing, that another gimmick, another way to promote a product, I guess. And there's nothing wrong with that. But I would prefer, in my personal opinion, if I like somebody, to buy their book or to go to their website or to learn something independently. I don't want to be part of, like, a group. Like, I'm never, if I'm going to be told that I have to pay X amount of dollars to join this group to discover something, I just won't do it because yeah. that's what I think. Like, I'm very contrarian that way.
Right. I mean, it's one thing if you want to, like, contribute to something. So I'm a member of the Libertarian Party mm-hmm. for whatever it's worth, and I paid a minimal amount to support them.
That's fine.
Yeah, but I don't think that that makes me more libertarian than the next person who didn't. It's not very important. It's not an important thing to me, and they're not revealing all their secrets to me because I paid a fee, you know?
No, they're not. And in fact, like, anybody can still be part of the Libertarian Party without making that contribution, right?
Exactly. They can. Yeah.
But then get this. There's that question on your taxes, and we've always hated that. Like, do you want to contribute X amount of dollars to this political campaign? I hate that question. Like, why does that have to be on my taxes? I already have to give all this money, and then you're asking for more when I'm, and that just annoys me.
I don't like that. And I also don't like it when I go to Walmart and they ask me if I want to give some extra money to charity as I'm checking out. That's really annoying too.
A really good response to that the other day. I could never say this, but she was so good. She goes, you know what? I have bought so much for my son and supported so many stores. I'm helping the economy as it is. I don't need to give any money to anybody else. The way she said it was just so, like, point on, and it just kind of shut down that question. But now CVS, like, instead of asking the question, they're just like, okay, there's a question on the screen and you can answer it. So they don't have to say it anymore. I still don't like being asked, but that's better than having them verbally ask you, I guess.
Right. And Facebook also has started doing all those contribute to somebody's birthday.
But I don't get that either. Like, okay, so it's like your birthday and you're asking people to make a contribution to this charity in lieu of a present. But to me, it's kind of odd because what if somebody just wanted to get you a present?
And they didn't want to get you a present.
They don't have to either. There's a lot of one thing I'm kind of immune to, but I get kind of criticized for, especially during the holidays. I've never felt like I'm obligated to get someone something if I don't want to, but you will get kind of criticized for that if you don't do it, like as being a curmudgeon or something. But maybe I'm on a budget and I can't afford to give money to every little event that people want to plan. Like, okay, that's great. Everybody wants to do a baby shower for so-and-so. Well, I don't always have money to give to this and to this and to this. And I finally got to the point I said, well, I have to be okay with that because it's not like they're going to be giving me money personally to help finance my life.
I became a mother rather late in life, and so all the people who were exactly the same age as I was, you know, I went to their showers or to their weddings or to their whatever. And of course, most of those people weren't even around when my daughter was born because it was a different set of people.
Yeah.
Even if you do have a baby after everybody else has a baby, you're not going to be considered. So it's you're made to feel that you need to contribute to other people's baby funds.
Yeah, that's kind of what it makes you feel like. And I have like the most interesting, just strange story. Another reason I don't really I'm not against the Jehovah's Witnesses, but one thing that they do to try and get people to be part of their organization is they do baby showers for people, or they bring people unsolicited gifts. Like, this happened to my sister. Like, these people saw that she had a baby and they just brought gifts to her door one day. And they were trying to get her into a conversation, and it made her feel really uncomfortable, and she had to go. She's like, I'm sorry, I have to go. But they try and do that to people. And then years ago, we went to this church, and I just had this most horrible experience because they decided to give my sister a baby shower. And me and my other sister saw all these gifts, and Jehovah's Witness kids are not allowed to have birthday parties, Christmases, or anything. And so I haven't seen gifts like in many, many years because we weren't allowed to have like wrapped up gifts, except at this, all of a sudden it was okay at a baby shower to have gifts, but never at birthdays, Christmases, or anything else. So me and my sister, we opened them because we thought it was fun. And I was 5 and she was 3. But the parents there, they told their kids to tell me that we were spoiled because we opened all these gifts that were supposed to be for my mom, who could barely move because she'd just given birth to a baby and couldn't open the gifts. And they told us that we were horrible people. Wow. And I was like, that was so strange. And that was a really strange experience, like very random, but just like,
yeah,
I don't know, just like, I kind of like, ever since I've had an interesting feeling towards baby showers, because I know most aren't like that, but just the whole idea that, oh, you have to give somebody something for this baby shower, but then there's all these expectations. And how does a 5-year-old know that they're not supposed to open the gifts at the baby shower? I guess we were brats, but whatever.
Yeah, that's a very strange thing to have happened. Yeah.
Yeah, it was very strange. And then the thing that was weird about that was that years later, that boy, like, he kind of still held it against me because we had opened the gifts of that shower. And he would tell me that years later, like at that class, like, it was such a strange experience. Like, I've never had good experiences with that religion. And I think it's really interesting now they target people. But yeah, they kind of do that too, where they'll bring you gifts and try and get you to be part of them. But then they have all these rules about how you're supposed to operate. I don't know. I just feel like a lot of gifts, there's all these expectations. Just give a gift if you want to. I don't think anybody's under any obligation to give gifts. That's all, you know?
Right. Yeah. When I was in Taiwan, I got a lot of gifts and I felt really bad about it because I didn't understand why people were giving me gifts and what it was for, you know?
And maybe they just did it because they wanted to. And I think that's okay if you want to give somebody something, but I don't think there should be this expectation that you have to give something back. I don't like that. Like, if you want to give somebody something, do it because you want to, not because you're expecting someone to return the gift.
Right, exactly.
Because
it's a business deal, right?
Yeah. I've given people things before, but I didn't expect things back, and I never got upset if I didn't receive a gift back. Like, I don't understand. Like, but personally, I just give things to people in a small group of friends and family. I've never been under these social, like, guilt expectations that I have to go to all these parties.
I lost the vision of you.
Sorry, are you still there?
Yes, I lost you for a moment.
Yeah, but I guess, like, I don't want to go off on a tangent. That was just all I was trying to say about gift giving. I feel like it's ritualized and it's just, you're made to feel guilty for it a lot of the time, and I don't think it's necessary.
Yeah, I agree. So I guess we should probably wrap it up because it seemed like for a minute there we were losing visual contact with each other. Did you feel that?
Yeah, it completely went away and I had to reconnect myself actually physically.
Okay. So next time we have a special plan. You and I will talk about it.
Okay.
In between.
Yeah, definitely. It sounds like it'll work out and I'm interested to see how it goes.
Okay. So it was great talking to you and we'll see you again same time in 1 week with a little bit of a difference.
Okay. Well, have a good night, Aya.
Good night, Julia.